أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام والتحية والإكرام على سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفي نفوسنا أبي القاسم محمد الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الصادقين المظلومين المنتجبين المنتخبين الذين أذهب الله عنكم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا
اللهم صل على
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام والتحية والإكرام على وصي مصطفى عبدك ووليك وأخي رسولك
ما شاء الله
وحجتك على خلقك وآيتك الكبرى والنبا العظيم أبا الحسنين مولى القونين إمام الثقلين يأسو بالدين سيد المتقين رأس المحسنين سلطان الأولياء أمير المؤمنين أول المسلمين أسد الله الغالب غالب كل غالب مظهر العجائب علي بن أبي طالب
اللهم صل على محمد.
الحمد لله الذي لا يحتف حجابه ولا يغلق بابه ولا يرد سائله ولا يخيب آمله. أما بعد فيقول الله في كتاب الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم كلا إن الإنسان ليبغى أن رآه استغنى. Brothers, sisters, respected elders, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. You found yesterday we discussed a number of key points that related to fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and whether we are hypocrites or not, and whether we truly believe in this religion or is it just merely on our tongues, like the example I gave of the parrot. And you find that when we did our shahada, like I mentioned last night, that we negated everything before we accepted this religion. Now when you come and accept this religion, you say, La ilaha illallah. So you say, there is nothing, there is no God, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you've realized that you've accepted that there is no attachment more important than the attachment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And indeed, we reach this position only through knowledge. That each and every one of us, we say that we have certain knowledge of certain things. And indeed, we do. Some of us within this room are knowledgeable within law. Others in engineering. Others in science. Others in debates. Others in Abrahamic faiths. And you find that each and every one of us within this room, we have some sort of knowledge that we can pass on to other mu'mineen and indeed our children as well. But you find that how did you come to that knowledge? And what level within that knowledge are you? So you find that the ulama come forward and they say that we've separated knowledges on different standings, on different stages and different levels. So what do you mean? He said the first level is the level of information. So you find when you write an essay, or you're about to prepare a speech, or you're about to write any sort of thing, and you're about to present something to people, or indeed present it to yourself, the first and foremost step is what? The gathering of information. The research aspect. And then when you gather all that information, what do? You filter the information so you know what you want to use and what you don't want to use. What you want to keep and what you want to discard. And you find that that first level is information. Then the level above that is knowledge. Something that we call ilm. Knowledge is that level where you filter through all the rubbish and you've come that this is true knowledge. And this is the thing that I'm going to put into the essay. This is the thing I'm going to put into my speech. This is the thing that I'm going to use in my life. That I've come forward and I've said, I've searched Christianity. And I don't think that God should be restricted to only a Sunday. I've come towards Judaism. And I've come to the conclusion that I don't think God should only be kept to a Saturday. I've come to the marhala of Islam. And Islam has told me that no, God is not worshipped on Sunday or Saturday, He's worshipped every single day. God is important every single day. That's why we pray 5 times a day. Yes, we have 5 separate prayers. And we devote that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's become knowledge now. So the information was what? I've searched through the religions and I've found that this religion tells me to worship God. Sacrifice my well-being, sacrifice my sleep in order to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we find we've come to prayer and we've said, yes, I've accepted prayer. Many of us, we know that we should pray. But that's only information for us, not knowledge. Because knowledge is when it comes into action. When you are doing that thing, then you can say, yes, I am knowledgeable about that. What's the level above that? The level above ilm is hikmah. To have wisdom. So I may be able to give a speech. Indeed, anyone from this gathering here tonight can probably give a speech. Anyone, isn't it true? Anyone give a speech? You find that it comes to the level of hikmah where you look at the people you are speaking to and you analyze what you're saying to fit the mind of the public. So I have to gauge my speeches to make sure that the children understand, the knowledgeable understand, the youngsters understand, the elders who may already heard things, bring new things so that they understand. And those people who are probably thinking that, yes, Muhammad, we've heard this before. So then I bring some philosophy to elaborate the subject so that they can understand a little bit more as well. So there's something for everyone. See, that's the level of hikmah when you analyze it. Another example can be given. You know, people say sometimes, what do they say? They say, you know, this guy is a spring of useless information. Isn't that true? Any useless piece of information, you'll have one friend. Any piece of useless information that means nothing, there'll be one guy who knows it all. And then you'll find that there's another guy who's knowledgeable. But you ask him anything, and you think the guy's going to hit something on your head. Why? Because he's got the knowledge, but he doesn't know how to present the knowledge to someone. He hasn't reached that level of hikmah. Then you've reached the level of hikmah where a person can analyze the knowledge, break it down and give it to you. But there's no spiritual dimension. There's no ma'rifah to his knowledge. Isn't it true? That there's no ma'rifah within his knowledge. That yes, he speaks eloquently. Yes, he speaks beautifully. Yes, he breaks down topics like no other person. But brothers, I don't feel any spirituality in his speeches. I don't feel that I'm getting any cleansing of my soul. I don't feel there's a tazkiyat al-nafs. I'm gaining things, but I'm not gaining spirituality from him. And that's why in Surah Hajj, verse 46 in the Holy Quran, Allah says that the eyes are not blind, but the hearts have become blind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when did the heart have eyes? There is a question. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that the eyes of the heart, the eyes of the heart within the chest have become blind. Or the hearts have become blind. Ya Allah, the hearts don't have eyes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to tell us something very important. He's trying to say that your spirits have become blind because of the sins that we are committing. That your eyes see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's beauty everywhere, but still you do not recognize the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And indeed, there are different levels of knowledge, say Muhammad. Why? Because even prophets within prophets can't understand other prophets. Isn't it true? I'll give you an example. Prophet Musa alayhi salam, he said, Ya Allah, I am your Nabi, I am your prophet. I wonder if I'm the most knowledgeable person on this earth. I wonder. As it is something not unusual. The Prophet of God is a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's getting ilham from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Indeed, he's one of the most knowledgeable people on the earth. Why? Because you've got direct connection to Allah. And you find that Allah says, there is a man waiting for you in a specific place near a river. Go towards the river. Prophet Musa goes on a journey. He goes on the journey and he finds a man by the name of Khidr. Some people say Khidr is a prophet, some people say he's a wise man. But let's just say, for argument's sake, he's a prophet. Let's just say that. So you find that these two prophets are speaking to one another. And Prophet Khidr says to Prophet Musa, he says, listen, we're going to go on a journey, and what you're going to see in this journey, be patient. Have sabr. We talked about sabr the other day. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu asbiru wa sabiru wa rabitu wa taqullaha la'allakum tuflihun. Inna Allaha ma'a sabirin. You find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has numerous verses about sabr. And you find that He says, have sabr when you see these things. So you find that they go on a journey. And on this journey, you find that Prophet Khidr says, whatever you see, be patient. He says, don't worry, don't be patient, don't worry. I'll be patient, no problem. So in the first stage of the journey, you find that Prophet Khidr kills a child. Prophet Musa looks at him and says, oh Khidr, what's wrong with you? Killing a child? Why are you killing the child? What's wrong with you? You're supposed to be a wise man. He said, did I tell you you won't be patient? As if you can't be patient, then don't waste my time. I told you to be patient. He says, no, I'm sorry. Let's go forward on the journey. I won't do it again. You find they came to the next stage and there was a boat there. There's a boat there and they traveled in the boat. And you find that Prophet Khidr begins to make holes in the boat. Prophet Musa turns to Prophet Khidr, says, oh Khidr, I said, why are you making holes in someone's boat? I said, it's not your boat. It's not your relation's boat that you're making holes in the boat. Yes? What are you doing? He says, didn't I tell you you won't be patient? Didn't I say to you you won't be patient? You're coming at me again? I said, calm down for a second. He said, no, I'm sorry. Last chance, I won't do it again. Last chance, I won't do it again. You know what's going to happen, right? So last chance, I won't do it again. So they go towards the third stage. At this point, they both become hungry. They go towards the village and they don't have any money. And they say, you know, we haven't got any money, but we are travelers. Please give us some food. They say, no money, no food. We've heard that one before, yes? No money, no food. When you show me the money, we'll give you the food. No money, no food. On your way. So Prophet Khidr sees a wall and the wall is breaking down. He goes to fix the wall. Prophet Musa says to him, oh Khidr, why are you fixing the wall? As in, we could have gone to the village and the villagers would have given us money to fix the wall. Then we could have ate something. I said, what's wrong with you? He says, listen Musa, I've had enough. Ma, I'm done. That's it. He He says, but before I let you go, I want to tell you something. He says, what do you want to say? He says, I want to tell you why I did what I did. He said, okay, then tell me, why did you do what you did? He said, the reason I killed the boy is because from the boy's lineage would have been X amount of mal'oon. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told me, kill that boy, for he would be a nuisance for his parents and Allah would bless him with a daughter. So why did you make holes in the boat? He said, because the king at the time was taking all the boats for his own personal gains. But if the boat was already damaged, it was cracked, then they wouldn't have taken the boat. So therefore I saved the person's rizq. So why did you fix the wall? He said, there was a mother and a father, they died and they left a treasure behind the wall for their children. And when their children would become of an age, the children would find that treasure. And they say that the king was looking for the treasure, so that's why I fixed the wall. Prophet Musa says, I see. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you? He said, yes, he did. He says, oh Musa, do you see the seagull? He says, I see the seagull. He says, do you see the seagull swooping down towards the water? He says, I see the seagull swooping down towards the water. He says, do you see the seagull's mouth opening towards the water? He says, I see the seagull's mouth opening towards the water. He says, do you see the seagull opening its mouth, taking the water and going towards the skies? He says, I see it. He says, do you see the droplets of water coming from the seagull's mouth and going back into the ocean? He says, I see it, O Khidr. He says, oh Musa, those droplets of water are our knowledge in comparison to the ocean of knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not come and tell and do not say that you have knowledge, the most knowledge on this earth. Because indeed Allah has always made someone better than even you. Brothers and sisters, this is the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He can give to anyone. Whoever He pleases and whoever He wants to give to, He will give. And that's what you find is the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That He gives this knowledge to whoever He pleases. But you can only accept this knowledge if you have a certain level of spirituality. Why? Because if you have a discussion, why are people arrogant nowadays? I think it's a very good question. As in, why are people arrogant? Some people are arrogant because of their clothing. Some people are arrogant because maybe they wear a nice watch. As in, you know, you've heard the line before. As I remember when I was in Australia, one of the brothers said to me, he goes, brother, one day, I said, what's going to happen one day? He goes, one day I'm going to buy a watch. He says, mashallah, watch, which watch is this? He says, it's going to be a watch that's worth about, so let's say $500,000. I said, mashallah, you know, I've never seen $500,000 in my life. Inshallah, when you become that rich, and don't forget Mawlana, yes? And you find that he says 500,000 for the watch. I said, why do you want the watch? He goes, because when I see people and they get loud to me, I said, you know, you get loud to me, be insulting towards me. I said, listen, stop talking. Because I can give you my watch and buy your house. Okay, so don't get arrogant with me. I said, for some people, even their clothing and their watches is arrogance for them. You find for some people what? For some people, their arrogance is bred through knowledge. So Muhammad, what do you mean? Knowledge is nur. As in, there's so many hadith that say that knowledge, ilm is nur. But you find that this is what it is. That although knowledge can be nur, it can also be a shar for you. It can be an evil for you. Why? Because our hearts are not clean. And that's why you find, brothers and sisters, what's happening in our community today. What's happening is we're not focusing on akhlaq. We're not focusing on, for example, such as tazkiyatul nafs. We're focusing on things like fiqh. Fiqh is important, no doubt about it. Jurisprudence is important. Law is important. Eschatology is important. And other things within the religion are important. But you find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants what? Before we go into any of these, to become a good human being. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came through the Prophet to perfect our akhlaq, to perfect our morals and our characteristics. As in Surah Jum'ah, verse number 2, You say that, we say this all the time. That we have sent to you what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you. He gave you what? The unlettered prophet who will recite the verses for you and will purify you. And then after your purification, will teach you the book. And after he teaches you the book, you find that you were in clear error before. After he teaches you the book, then you will come on Sirat al-Mustaqim. Every Jummah we read this surah. But when was the last time we actually read the surah? Understand the point. As in we heard the surah, when was the last time we actually listened to the surah? When was the last time we read the translation of that surah? And you find that this is the utmost importance. What I'm trying to bring out to you is sincerity. Where is the sincerity in our prayers? Where is the sincerity in our fasting? Where is the sincerity, dare I say, even within our azadari? Brothers and sisters, ask yourself the question, where is the sincerity within our azadari? As in, if I ask a question to many of you here tonight, I say, brother, when you do matam, yes, when you strike your chest, what is the philosophy of you striking your chest? Many people want to know the answer. Why? Because they never thought about it. They just think, yeah, I'm striking my chest, I'm crying. Hit, hit, hit. No, no, brothers and sisters, we need to understand that azadari is so much more. I remember reading in, I can't remember where, but it said something very beautiful about this matam, and I want to share it with you here tonight. And it shows you what sincerity really is. It wrote in the book, it said that we say that every time we slap our chest, it is a slap on the face of the Yazidis or Yazid himself. Yes? Because we are remembering who? Abu Abdullah. He says that, in my opinion, that's not the case. So what's your opinion? He said, in my opinion, when we are slapping our chest and we are causing pain to our chest, he said, what is our chest? It is the carrier of our heart. And our heart throughout the year has become rusty. It has become locked. He said, through hitting the lock, we will break the lock of our heart. By hitting our chest, we will transfer the nur from the hand through that gum, through that sorrow, through that pain, and we will transfer the nur of Ahlul Bayt from our hands to our chest, to our hearts. Francis, when was the last time we actually thought about what we're doing? That we go into sujood, these are the same positions that the Ahlul Bayt have gone into. When was the last time we thought about sujood? Brothers and sisters, prophets were made in sujood. Imams were made in sujood. When was the last time we did sujood? Brothers and sisters, when we're in sujood, straight up. Brother, you're not going to do sujood after your prayers? No, I'm not interested. Straight to ziyarat. That to the extent that Prophet Nuh alayhi salam was told by the angels, they said, there will be a time when man will only live for 50, 60 years. You know, he turned around and said, he goes, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if I was only on this earth for 50 years, then I would have spent 50 years in sujood. And we don't even care about sujood. And when we do sajda, we're not even bothered. We don't understand the brilliance of that position. And by breeding this sincerity within our hearts, it will be the difference between yaqeen and shak. When we have yaqeen within our hearts, the brothers say, what can't we achieve as a community? What can't we achieve? And I remember Ayatollah Khomeini gives a very beautiful example. He says that the mind has... They said, can you give us an example of yaqeen and shak? He says, yes. He says, it's the example of a dead man. He says, what do you mean the example of a dead man? It's the example of a dead man. That there's a man, he's accepted that this person is dead. With his mind. But if you say to the same man that there's a dead body, and you're going to spend a night with the dead body in one room all alone, they'll say, no. So, are you mad? Me? Spend a whole night with a dead body alone in the dark? Says, well, why? Why? If you claim that you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you love Ali Muhammad, and you believe in the hereafter, and once you die, you're dead, that's it, you can't come back. And you claim to be Shia Ali, and you know, I want to be in Imam Zaman's army, then what's the problem with staying with the dead body in the midst of the night? No problem. Yes? It seems like those who shout too much are the ones to run away first, yes? So you find that this is what's happening. And he says that this is the difference between yaqeen and shak. That it's been accepted by the mind but not the heart. Because if accepted by the heart, then there could have been 100 dead bodies in a room. You could have put a mu'min there and he wouldn't have had a problem. And likewise, the difference between yaqeen and shak is such that they say that the sixth imam told one of his companions, he says, go into the fire, go into the furnace. What does the man say? He says, ya imam, what do you mean go into the furnace? You're supposed to be my imam. Why are you telling me to go into the furnace and kill myself? I'm not committing suicide. See, accepted by the mind, but not accepted with the heart. And then there was another companion. And imam said, go into the fire. He says, na'am yabna Rasulullah, inside, he's gone. He's gone, he comes back out. He says, this is why Ali Muhammad does not revolt. This is why Ali Muhammad does not go and stand up. This is why we stay quiet. Because we do not even have followers who will listen to us. How can we? Brothers and sisters, we shout about Imam Zaman, Imam Zaman, Imam Zaman, but we don't have any sincerity in our hearts. We read Allahumma kulli waliyyaka al-hujjat ibn al-hasan salawatuka alayhi wa ala abai fi hadhi sa'ati wa fi kulli sa'ah. And we ask Imam, come towards us. We can't even wake up for salat al-layl. We ask Imam, Imam, come towards us. We are sincere. We cry. We need to really understand that where are we and what are we doing, and we have to be truthful to ourselves, brothers and sisters. Are we truthful to ourselves? See, we have not even gained this sincerity within our hearts. People like Jabir ibn Abdullah Ansari, one of the greatest companions that saw all of the Imams up to the fifth Imam. From the Prophet all the way to the fifth Imam. He had lost his eyesight, but yet he didn't lose the sight of his heart. We need to be like Jabir ibn Abdullah Ansari. You know, we need to be like these holy personalities. Because if we do not have sincerity in our hearts, then how do we expect to move forward? And just before I do go into Masaib, I want to leave you with this. That there was a scholar in Qom. And this scholar has studied for 30 years, brothers and sisters. Someone like me, I've studied for 5-6 years. I've lectured for 4-5 years. He studied for 30 years. They say this scholar used to read Ziyarat-e-Waritha and Ziyarat of Ashura every single day without fail. Every single day. And you know what he said? He said one day, he said, you know what, I've reached, after 30 years, I believe I've reached a position where I could be one of the 72 of Abu Abdullah. They say that the scholar fell asleep. He fell asleep in a dream. And a dream came to him. And he was in Karbala. He was in Karbala and he was one of the men standing in front of Abu Abdullah whilst he was praying. And everybody knows that those people who are standing in front of Abu Abdullah took the arrows on their hearts. They didn't move out of the way. They took the arrows on their hearts. They say, I was standing. front of Abba Abdullah after 30 years of studying, after reading Zaratashura for God knows how many years, every single day without fail. He goes, Wallah Abba, when the arrow came towards me, I moved out of the way and it struck Abba Abdullah in my dream. Knowledge does not equal sincerity, brothers and sisters. Ritualistic practices do not equal sincerity, brothers. Sincerity comes from here and here alone. And you find how sincere were the companions of Abba Abdullah. Scratch that. How sincere was Abba Abdullah himself? I ask you, how sincere was he? Now, if you want to see true sincerity, then I ask you, any king, any general will sacrifice each and every one of his soldiers to death. Isn't it true? Which general, which king, which leader do you know that will sacrifice his own family for his beliefs? Name me a leader. There is none. Abba Abdullah is the only leader to have sacrificed each one of his females, each one of his males, for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because he had sincerity in his heart. How many of us would be willing to sacrifice our small children on that day? How many of us would be willing to sacrifice the hijab of our ladies on that day? Our sisters. And you find that we spoke about Muslim last night. And Muslim came to the position where he was attacked by the enemy. And we left the maqtal where? We left the maqtal when Muslim was there and his body was dragged in the streets of Kufa after his head was beheaded and he was thrown off the balcony with Hani bin Urwa. You find that his body was dragged in the streets and then they were crucified. And when they were crucified, you find that Muslim left two sons, brothers and sisters. He left two sons by the name of Muhammad and Ibrahim. And when he left these two sons, Muhammad and Ibrahim, you find Muhammad and Ibrahim were left there all alone in Kufa. That there's no one there to surround them. And they're all alone in the dungeon. And when they're in this dungeon, you find that they're praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they're saying that our father was crucified in Kufa. Our father's body was galloped in the streets of Kufa, and now we are all alone and there's no one here beside us. The God came towards Muhammad and Ibrahim to give them some food. They ate the food and the man asked, who are you, O children? And they said, we are the son of Muslim. The God allowed them to leave the prison in the midst of the night. And when they left the prison in the midst of the night, you find that the morning came and they were near the river of Euphrates, because the Euphrates river runs through Kufa. You find that they were near the river of Euphrates and they went towards the water. They picked the water up with their hands and they drank the water. What say, O Muhammad and Ibrahim, come towards Nainawa. Your cousin Sakina is running from one tent and running to the other. Saying Al-Adaj, Al-Adaj. Al-Fadl al-Abbas. Then they say, when Zagina asked for the water, Abbas went towards the water. He went towards the water like Muhammad and Ibrahim picked up the water. But the difference between Muhammad and Ibrahim and Al-Fadl al-Abbas was that Al-Fadl threw the water back into the Euphrates and said, how can I drink this water when Zagina does not have any water? How can I drink this water when the 6-month-old baby does not have any water? How can I drink this water when Abdullah has no water? And they say, Muhammad and Ibrahim, a lady comes towards them and says, who are you, O children, and why are you crying by the river of Euphrates? The lady says, why are you crying? And they say, we are the orphans of Muslim, the one whose body was thrown off the balcony. The lady says, come towards my house, O Muhammad and Ibrahim, I will give you protection. They say, the lady takes the children to her mistress and says, oh mistress, these are the children of Muslim, please give them protection. The lady gives them protection until a man comes who is her husband and beats the lady to the ground and says, you are the children of Muslim, I will behead you. And they say, they tie the children of Muslim to the pillar all night. And when it came toward the morning, the man did not take Muslim children with his hands, rather he dragged them towards the Euphrates River. And when he dragged them towards the Euphrates River, brothers and sisters, you find that Muslim children said, will you kill us today? He said, yes, I will kill you and present your heads to Ibn Ziyad for a mighty reward. He takes the children, and the children say, oh man, please give us time so that we can pray our Fajr prayers. They raise their hands towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and collectively they read a du'a. What do they say, brothers and sisters? The lines are absolutely destructive. They say, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have already become orphans, and give our mother patience when she hears that we have been killed. I would say, oh Muhammad and Ibrahim, when you were killed, your bodies went towards the Euphrates River. Come towards Nainawa. Come towards Nainawa and see the bodies on the ground. The bodies on the ground.